These are 5 Nobel Prize winners who caused irreversible harm to human civilization.
That non-violence is the answer to the crucial political and moral questions of our time.
Number 5. Antonio Egas Moniz.
The psychiatrist decided that this was the situation for me.
If you're dealing with anxiety, insomnia, or any other mental health issue, be glad you didn't pop out 100 years back. Our story takes us back to 1848, when an accidental explosion lodges a railway spike into a man's head. Amazingly, the man survived. His memory was still intact. He could speak. His motor functions were fine. But his personality was a bit different. He became extremely mean and aggressive all day, every day. That's like me watching a football match. The part of the brain that was damaged, his frontal cortex, is the part that controls our emotions. Doctors and researchers from all over the world were fascinated by this incident and flocked to understand which part of the brain controls what behavior. One of these researchers was a Portuguese neurologist, Antonio Egas Moniz. Moniz had spent years working with severely depressed patients and had developed a theory that mental illness was caused by the malfunction of the frontal cortex. His solution? Sever the connection from the frontal lobe to the rest of the brain. I told you we are lucky. Moniz's first patient or victim was a 60-year-old prostitute suffering from psychosis. He and his lab assistant drilled 2 holes onto her skull and injected pure alcohol to destroy the nerve connections between the brain and the frontal lobe. And the operation worked in the sense that the woman stopped displaying symptoms of psychosis. Her disruptive thoughts seemed to have completely vanished, but so did all her emotions. It completely depersonalized her, stripping her of everything that makes us human. This process of severing the frontal lobe came to be known as lobotomy. Moniz's work soon caught on in the United States, and after World War II, more than 5,000 lobotomies were conducted every year. In 1949, Antonio Egas Moniz won the Nobel Prize for Medicine. Fortunately for us, doctors and government soon realized that people who received lobotomies could no longer concentrate, appeared unmotivated, and completely lost interest in their own lives. In almost all countries, lobotomy is no longer practiced and is considered unethical. Although if my team keeps losing this way, I most certainly might need a lobotomy. Number 4. Fritz Haber.
The root cause will be starvation.
If you're watching this video, you probably owe your life to this guy. Let me explain. Our body needs certain amount of nitrogen to create stuff like proteins, hemoglobin, DNA and RNA, which are the building blocks of life on Earth. Most of the nitrogen in our body comes from plants, directly or indirectly. And plants in turn get their nitrogen from the soil. The problem is that if we keep farming the same land over and over again, more and more of the nitrogen in the soil gets used up. Eventually, there isn't enough nitrogen for healthy plants to grow. In the 1800s, this was such a big problem that the most common cause of death was starvation, and the average life expectancy was below 30. And I just turned 30. But one fine day, something miraculous happened. A German Jewish scientist, Fritz Haber, combined naturally occurring nitrogen from the air with hydrogen to create ammonia fertilizer. Mankind could finally create bread from thin air. Suddenly, in the same plot of land, farmers could grow 4 times the yield. As a result, population of the earth doubled in just a few years. And then World War I happened. Haber was a German patriot and wanted to use his expertise to help his country. He modified his fertilizer plant to produce a deadly explosive, commonly called TNT. But that's just a start. His blind loyalty and patriotism led him to create the chlorine gas. At 6 p.m. on the 22nd of April, German troops released 168 tons of chlorine gas onto British trenches. Any soldier that inhaled a lungful of gas suffered a terrible death. Even the grass that came in its path would shrivel and die. Fritz Haber won the Nobel Prize for his ammonia fertilizer in 1918, and in 1934, he died of a heart failure. But he had one last contribution to the world. After the creation of chlorine gas, Haber was working on an even more potent chemical called Zyklon B. Unbeknownst to him, only 10 years after Haber's death, Zyklon B was used to perpetrate the Holocaust. So maybe it's a good idea for scientists to focus on science and stay away from politics altogether. I think that statement is going to bite me in the ass very soon. Stay tuned.
Number 3.
Henry Kissinger.
I think that a country that will not stick by its friends will not be taken seriously by its adversaries.
In the 1960s, there were two prevailing ideologies in the world. The United States stood for democracy and the free markets, while the Soviet Union led the charge for socialism. If your country believed in socialism, then you were a direct threat to the United States. One such country was Vietnam, who were in a bloody war with the US for 20 long years. It's during this time that a young professor of international affairs at Harvard, Henry Kissinger, was appointed by Richard Nixon as National Security Advisor. The politician and the professor, who knew that this duo would shape the world for years to come. Their first task, end the war in Vietnam. US intelligence had gotten information about some North Vietnamese soldiers hiding in the neighboring Cambodia, an independent free country. And so, Kissinger sanctioned the indiscriminate carpet bombing of Cambodia. This was against international law and was considered a horrific war crime. Kissinger and Nixon would go on to carpet bomb another tiny neighboring country in Laos. To this day, Laos remains the most bombed country in history. While entire countries were being bombed and thousands of innocent lives were lost daily, Kissinger was relaxing in Florida with the president. Between 1954 to 1975, more than 3 million people died in the Indochina region. Eventually, the two countries signed a peace settlement to end the war. Henry Kissinger and Lê Đắc Tô, his Vietnamese counterpart, were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. But Lê Đắc Tô had declined the award, stating that the US had already violated the ceasefire agreement. There were thousands of protesters awaiting Kissinger outside the ceremony hall, and so he sent the US ambassador to accept the award. On 30th of April 1975, the Vietnam War finally ended. But Henry Kissinger wasn't done yet. He backed Indonesia's invasion of East Timor, Pakistan's genocidal war against Bangladesh, Turkey's invasion of Cyprus. The list goes on and on. Oh, and Kissinger was a secret consultant to George W. Bush's administration and urged the expansion of the war in Iraq, stating, because Afghanistan was not enough and we need to humiliate them. Number 2. Werner Heisenberg. Remember what I said about scientists sticking to science? Werner Heisenberg was a German physicist famous for his contributions to quantum mechanics. He came up with the quantum uncertainty principle, a concept that revolutionized the field of physics, for which he won the Nobel Prize in 1932. I highly recommend Veritasium's video on the double split experiment if you want to go deeper into this topic. By the 1930s, he was widely regarded as the leading nuclear physicist in the world. And then Hitler attacked Poland. World War II began, and almost every theoretical physicist, including Albert Einstein, left Germany either out of fear or out of principle. But Heisenberg stayed back. He felt that he had to ignore politics and the immoral acts of the Nazis in order to save German science. Hitler will lose his war. Consequently, much of Germany will be destroyed. But the value of science will still be there. And it is necessary that science should live through the war, and we must do something for that. So what did he do? He started working on a nuclear bomb for Hitler. Who knew that this decision would ignite a chain reaction that would make humanity capable of destroying itself? News of Heisenberg's involvement reached the Pentagon, and the urgency to create a nuclear bomb before Hitler was at an all-time high. So the United States reached out to the greatest project manager in the history of the universe. On August 6th, 1945, the first nuclear bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, killing more than 250,000 people, most of whom were civilians. 3 days later, another bomb was dropped on Nagasaki, with 50,000 more casualties. The war was over, but the world would never be the same. It was the fear of Heisenberg in particular that forced the United States to devote so much time and money into developing the nuclear bomb. This is what I learned from the story. Number one, scientists and engineers must be taught ethics and morality in schools. And number two, Oppenheimer was the greatest project manager in the history of the universe. If you enjoy the video thus far, do hit the like button. It's the only way the YouTube AI recognizes me. And for top sevens on science, tech, and research, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell icon. Number one, Alfred Nobel.
One tiny flaskful of this yellow, oily liquid contains enough power to blow this laboratory off the planet.
For more than a century, the Nobel Prize has been awarded to individuals for their outstanding contributions in the field of physics, chemistry, medicine, economics, literature, and peace. Winners receive a medal and around $1 million in cash. You might want to know where this money comes from. Alfred Nobel was born into a rich family in Sweden, with his father being the inventor of plywood. At the age of 15, his father sent him to Paris for his further studies. This is where he met Ascanio Sobrero, who recently invented nitroglycerin, a highly inflammable chemical that could potentially be used to create deadly explosives. But the problem with nitroglycerin was that it was extremely unpredictable and very, very difficult to control. For the next 15 years, Alfred spent days and nights trying to tame nitroglycerin. And so, in 1867, he finally accomplished his lifelong mission of trying to control this weird chemical, and he called it dynamite. This made him rich beyond belief, with an estimated net worth of over $300 million. Alfred was convinced that his creation would eventually lead to world peace, as countries would be too scared to use these explosives on each other. Well, that's not how the world saw it. In 1888, when Alfred's brother Ludwig died, the newspapers reported that it was Alfred who was the one who passed away. One French headline announced, "The Merchant of Death is dead." Another newspaper stated, "Dr. Alfred Nobel, the mutilator, who became rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before, died yesterday." Nobel was devastated and realized that he had to whitewash his entire reputation for the sake of his own legacy. And so for the next 2 years, he and his estate agent worked on a will like no other. And that's how, ladies and gentlemen, the Nobel Prize was born. Now, evil scientists and politicians messing up the world is one thing, but evil CEOs are on a whole nother level. So check out the 7 CEOs who poison the world for profit. I'll see you there.